Now today's topic is mental, soric mentals, right? So we are talking about this book of the end of my assumption. Okay. So earlier, when we used to study in college, we would all read about myisms, and every one of us and everyone who was taught by our different teachers had different concepts around it. The basic Hahnemannian knowledge about myisms had lost somewhere. Okay, we used to read Ogonen, we used to read all those books, but somewhere around along the line, we were not able to understand how we can connect myisms to our current situation, how we can connect myisms and gain its knowledge and try to apply it in a practical way and in a daily practice. Okay, so we would all just mug it up, we will all just read it and write it down in exams and just pass. And then we used to forget about it. So the result was what I am sure each and every student of homeopathy who is a current student or who has been practicing since some years, who was a pass out, has gone through the same dilemma where we could not understand how to bridge that gap, how to apply the basics of myism to the practical world we are dealing with. Okay, sir was really important in his teachings here. There were very important teachings, not because they were very high standard or very colorful in words, because he just tore it apart. He just put it very simply, in a very sober manner, and he made us understand. It was like a preschool again, where we first start with ABCD and then we go to phonics and then we go to two letter words and three letter words, and then we understand, okay, this is how we read sentences and this is how we can get better in spoken English. The same way sir just tore apart the old myisms, and in a very simple manner he wrote down everything, why myisms are important, how our body is and mind are in collaboration with each other, in harmony with each other, how diseases start, what is the base of those diseases, how they progress. And we have read it in theory of suppression also, how the single string of diseases, how diseases work upwards through the energy levels, okay, the seven layers. Okay, so here after the seven layers, many of us practice homeopathy, but we are not able to understand how to bring in myisms, and how do we understand in the patient or in a disease how the disease is progressing in a myismatic way. So sir, in the earlier chapters we have read about the physical concept of myism. Okay, psora, psychosis, syphilis. Sir has very beautifully explained it is all but a defense mechanism. A mind and the body, they work in collaboration, and everything which happens in the mind is reflected in the body in the same manner. Okay, in the form of signs and symptoms. So we have understood how defense mechanism is basically psora, which is irritation, and then it moves into the next defense mechanism, which is the psychosis or accumulation, construction, or psychosis excess or psychosis less, and then how the body shifts the gear to syphilis. When the earlier defense mechanisms are not sufficient, then the body shifts the gear to syphilis. In the same manner, the mind also, okay, has the same mechanism, and the mind also works in three different areas of myism: psora, psychosis, syphilis. So today we are starting with soric mentals. Now, why mentals are important? Every one of us knows ki jab hum log, when we start with the, what is the basis of all homeopathic practice or any practice, any doctor, the basis is the case taking. If you're dealing with any disease or any patient, the basis is case taking. Now in homeopathic case taking, it is vital, it is the most important to understand that to take whatever is important, okay, then we analyze, then we shift it into the different rubrics, and we have too much of focus on the different rubrics. Now I want to tell you, like, I was like any other common homeopath. वी वुड ऑल इट इट वॉज अ सी, कहते हैं ना जैसे एक सुई को ढूंढना पूरी इन अ हेस्टिक इन अ हेस्टॉक. सो आई यूज टू सर्च लाइक कुछ भी मिल जाए, डूबते को तिनके का सहारा सही, कि कुछ भी मिल जाए, सम की नोट्स और सम पर्टिकुलर्स ऑफ अ मेंटर्स और सम फिजिकल पर्टिकुलर्स, एंड वी वुड जस्ट रीड, वी हैड ऑल लर्न्ड दोज वन लाइनर्स की पल्सेटला है तो कैसी पिक्चर होगी. इट माइट बी दैट पल्सेटला पिक्चर जो हम लोगों ने पढ़ी है, द मेंटल एंड फिजिकल रूब्रिक्स आर ऑल वन साइडेड, ओनली साइकोटिक पिक्चर. और इट कुड बी दैट जो सल्फर हम लोग जानते हैं वो एक वन साइडेड एक माइजम की पिक्चर है. We never could understand and we never were told that every medicine and every, we never knew that every disease has three aspects, right? Jabki hum logo ko apni physiology and we learned that in our pathology as well. So how could, we never knew that even the medicine and even the patient is running all through all those miasms, and even the medicine has all three pictures, psoric picture, psychotic picture and syphilitic picture. So he would be, we would be dealing with the medicine which has psoric physicals and psoric mental rubrics and psychotic mentals and psychotic physicals and syphilitic physicals and syphilitic mentals. Okay. So then we would just take some of the other thing. We'll just put in a combination and just we'll give whatever we feel like. It would never be a symptom. And jab bhi wo symptom nahi hoti, obviously we would either get very small results or very scarce results, or the results would either be very severe suppressions, okay, or palliations. And then we would be very dejected and we would feel like nahi, homeopathy does not work and it is all a facade. And we would ultimately turn to allopathy or other less important sciences, or we would go into other fields to build our careers, okay. So here, why these mentals are really important, here we understand how the defense mechanism, as we have understood earlier also, how the physical miasms work, here we understand how the mentals, in the mentals, how the miasms work, what are the psoric mentals of a patient, of a constitution, how the patient shifts its gear, why the patient shifts its gear to the psychotic mentals, and why the patient shifts its gear to the syphilitic mentals, and how can we decipher it? How can we acknowledge that this is psoric mental, this is psychotic mental, this is the phase in which the patient is coming to us, and we have to take this particular thing. The most important aspect which I found in predictive homeopathy, why predictive homeopathy helped me. See, I have some basic things which I want to share with you. When we went to predictive homeopathy in Mumbai, and there I'm very grateful to my panel and the teachers who taught us that. They told us the one most important thing that every one of the panels told us was just empty your brain. अगर आपको लगता है, ये exact words है which I am saying, अगर आपको लगता है कि अभी आपने 5 से 6 साल में या 7 साल में कुछ भी पढ़ाई की है तो भूल जाइए वो सब. जब आप वो पूरा भूल जाएंगे, when you will be able to empty your brain and empty all the half cooked, half baked and false knowledge which we thought made us toppers and which made us very good students, जब वो सब हम लोग भूल जाएंगे तब हम लोग real में जो homeopathy है उसका base बना पाएंगे, ठीक है. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, अगर एक गमला है, देयर इज अ पॉट एंड देयर इज ऑलरेडी अ प्लांट ग्रोइंग इन दैट पॉट, देन इफ यू सो अ सीड, ऑब्वियसली दैट पॉट सोइल एंड दैट न्यूट्रिएंट्स विल नॉट बी इनफ, द न्यू सीड विल ईदर हैव स्टंटेड ग्रोथ और इट विल जस्ट डाई आफ्टर सम टाइम. ओके, सो वी हैव टू जस्ट एम्प्टी आवर कप, एंड दीज बेसिक्स आर रियली इंपॉर्टेंट. एंड सेकेंड थिंग जो हम लोग को जो हम लोग के प्रेडिक्टिव पैनल ने बोली थी, वो ये बोली थी कि बिफोर learning anything practically, just go back to basics. What are the basics? The three books which sir wrote, jisme se abhi we are reading the third book. Okay, so when we took it very lightly, we said ha hum logo ne kai baar padha hua hai and what is the use, we have learned so much, we have read organon, ha miasms to hum logo ko aata hai. But when we started reading it again and again, and I'll tell you, till date I've been practicing since so many years, but till date whenever I read sir's books like this chapter, okay, I find some of the other thing which is very unique to me. Maybe I read it before, but I could not click onto it. And now I can understand and correlate to it and apply it in my practice. So the understanding gets better and better. So I'll tell all the future homeopaths and the practicing homeopaths, please take these books very seriously. You people are very lucky that you are getting all of this online. And just go through the Sadhana series earlier and continue with this Sadhana series and you'll learn a lot. I've had feedback from many students and practitioners who are attending these Sadhana series. And they are telling me that this has, and I'm talking about those homeopaths who have been practicing since 10 to 15 years. And they are telling me that this Sadhana series has really helped them in getting results in the right way. The results have increased by 80 to 90% in some students, some practitioners who are practicing since many years. Because hum log mixopathy ko chhod ke, we start understanding how to take the case, what is important in a follow-up, when to change the remedy, when to continue with the same remedy, when to... somebody is raising the hand. Please, if you have any questions, just type in the questions so that we'll take the question later. Okay, so why these soric mentals are important? Because hum log bahut focus karte hai, we focus a lot on rubrics and we focus a lot on mental rubrics. But we do not understand that the rubrics which we are taking so much into importance are... we do not understand whether they are psychotic rubrics or syphilitic rubrics or soric rubrics, and we just take it ki jo bhi mil raha hai wo sab repertory mein daliye, just enter into the software and then the jo medicines aa jati hain. We try to analyze those medicines also on the basis of whatever half knowledge we have. कोई होता है ना द एलिफेंट, जो सर ने पहले एग्जाम्पल दिया है, देयर इज अ ह्यूज एलिफेंट एंड एवरीवन इज ट्राइंग टू टेक नोटिस ऑफ वन ऑफ इट्स पार्ट एंड थिंकिंग दैट दैट इज द होल ऑर्गेनिज्म. ओके, सो सोरिक मेंटल्स, एंड मेंटल्स आर रियली इंपॉर्टेंट. सो सोरिक मेंटल्स आर द बेसिस वेयर वी विल अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज द माइंड्स ग्राउंड, हाउ द मेंटल लेवल ऑफ अ पेशेंट, of a constitution, how a constitution basically build. Hum log in predictive homeopathy case taking, the need, the sensitivity, the reactions are really important. Okay, that define the constitution of a patient. So here we will understand what can be the basic needs of the patient, some rubrics, how do we take consideration of some rubrics like precocity, what is precocity, what is conscientious diligent, and many other things. Okay, how do we proceed through a person's life? How do we know how a person's life is going forward? And how do we know whether the patient who's coming to us is in what mental miasm, what stage of miasm? Whether he is in soric miasm or he is in soropsychotic phase or psychosyphilitic phase. So we'll just understand the mind and the body, we'll take that in consideration and we'll understand what are the soric mentals, what are the psychotic mentals, how to rule out the psychotic mentals. Kyunki jab usually hum log ke paas patients aate hain, they do not come in soric condition, they come in psychotic or psychosyphilitic condition, and they we give because they are talking throwing out too much of psychosis at us and we are just catching that up. So we are all lost in that psychotic mentals and concept, and we give the wrong remedy. See, the physicals can be are very important, but they are clearer. We can understand ha ki ek psychotic physical agar koi hum log ko mil raha hai symptom or sign or some disease, we can just rule out ha ki ha this is a psychosis phase. But mentals, it gets really really difficult, and when the patient is in psychosis or in psychosyphilitic, then he gets into all kinds of mental phases where he's trying to manipulate us, where he's trying to hide himself, okay, mentally, and we get lost in that. So we'll understand what is the basic, and then how to break that psychosis and reach to the real person, to the real constitution, to the real sensitivity, to the real needs, to the real reactions the patient is giving, why he is giving that, what rubrics to take, what rubrics to ignore. Okay, so let's start. Sir says in this chapter, a cell is born with a purpose. The purpose may be twofold. It can be two functions, okay? Jointly with other cells, it may form a continuous sheath called tissue. This can afford protection to an organ or delicate parts. The first function is to provide protection, okay, with other cells. The second function, the cell has its own individuality also. So it has its own function to perform. So the second function is to synthesize enzymes, neurotransmitters, amino acids, and the different protein components. Besides these two obvious functions, it has a very primary function, the very basic function without which the whole individual would not last. That primary function is to convert the nutritive elements to energy or ATP. Okay. So, jo ye teen functions hai, what are the three functions? To provide protection, to synthesize enzymes, neurotransmitters, and to give energy. Okay, so in three functions, may say the most important function is to obviously to give energy, to synthesize ATP. So the previous two functions depend entirely on the cell performing its first function well. A cell thereby has a great healthy. For this, every cell is rewarded back because the whole organism is a social order of 75 to 100 trillion cells. See, sir here also said, and every time we used to hear from sir and every panel there, that we as human beings are not single entities. We are a social organism, okay? Everything is united. There's no I, there's we. Okay, so here also sir has mentioned very subtly that it is a social order of 75 to 100 trillion cells. Okay, and this sir has written so much time back. Now it is being proven, and it is very into in fashion that we all know quantum physics, and we all know we are energy and a group of we have more bacteria and viruses in our body than our original human cells. Okay, so we are a social order. As life goes on, what is important for every being is to conscientiously work for the purpose for which he or she is born for or exists. So we are very concerned with conscientious diligence. Okay, we try to, this is the basic where we try to differentiate the remedies or the person. That if a person was coming to us, the first thing we try to take out in the case taking is whether the person is conscientious or diligent or not. Okay, so here sir tells, what is conscientious working? Conscientious working is the work which a person or a cell does without any hidden greed or without any result which he expects in return. Okay, so conscientious work for the purpose for which he or she is born for or exists. So jab life jo hoti hai wo tab it goes on in a very harmonious way when what is important for every being is to work conscientiously, when everyone is working conscientiously for the purpose for which he is born or she is born or exists. A man has to work for his daily bread, they say. So if he earns his daily bread, food, the source of energy, we cannot live without food, we cannot live without oxygen. So that is the basic need. The basic needs are sora. Okay. He will be able to live and let live. This means that there'll be harmony within and without. Within our body and outside our body and mind, there'll be harmony. Energy or ATP energy, which is so gained, is not wasted in fighting or quarreling. See, when there's optimum for everyone, every cell, every human being is doing the work he or she is assigned, for which he or she is born, to bring harmony in the body and mind, to bring harmony in the society, then the energy which is created is obviously that is optimum. Everyone is getting the energy that is needed by each and every cell. So, aisa nahi hoga na ki someone is getting less, someone is getting more, or someone is accumulating more than what is needed. So, there will be no energy which will be wasted in fighting or quarreling. Okay. So, this energy will tune the whole system in such a manner that the system within and without becomes more efficacious. It becomes more efficient. It works in a much better way towards a higher purpose of life. As efficiency increases, as jaise efficiency increase hoti hai, less amount of energy is consumed for normal processes because everything starts working in an automatic manner, and whatever is needed by one cell is consumed and then passed on to the other cell. So it works on in an automatic manner. Less amount of energy is consumed and the energy which is left, okay, now can be devoted to evolve for a higher purpose. This has been the basis of our human evolution. Okay, nature has provided, we were in harmony with nature. Okay, so we were first, we were a single cell, and then we got into multiple, multicellular cells, and then we evolved higher and higher. And now we are human beings, and now our forebrains are there, and different functions are there. So how do you think that was possible? Agar do amoeba aapas mein lad rahe hote, or when we were unicellular, multicellular organisms, and we would have been fighting for the energy for ourselves only. Let us consume more, let us consume more. There's nothing for other cells. There should be nothing for everyone. Okay, then evolution would have never been possible. We would not have been here the way we are. Okay, but somehow we are forgetting that now. Now everyone is working only for themselves. So that is why sir said everyone is going towards syphilis. The human race is going towards syphilis. Okay, so we as, one more thing, we as homeopaths should understand, one more thing is there, we should understand, if we see a layman does not have this knowledge, okay, so he does not even know why he is converting into an animal that he is today. But we as homeopaths, we have this knowledge. So the most important thing is to first understand this knowledge and apply it in our lives, and then to just transmit this knowledge to whoever thinks wants to know. Okay, so the efficiency increases, and this is how we want. So and mind will be happy, materialistically contented, and can think of things beyond material existence or beyond normal senses, but rationally. Okay, so here sir has explained very beautifully that when we do not have to fight at energy, at cellular level and at a mind level, at a human being level. What is the, earlier in the chapter, we have already dealt with what is the mind of the cell. Okay, so those who have not read the earlier chapter, just go through the last lecture and you will understand. So the mind will be happy at the cellular level, at the organism level, and at the society level. Then materialistically contented, obviously material gains are important. We need to have the basic needs. Okay, we need to have that, but usse zyada hum logo pass on kar dena chahiye. And can think of things beyond material existence or beyond normal senses, but rationally. So this is how evolution will happen. Then if a man is to remain healthy, every organ and therefore every cell has to function properly and conscientiously. If every cell works conscientiously to produce energy, there will be sufficient energy to carry on normal assigned functions as well as become prosperous and evolve. This rational thinking leads to progress of man. Okay, so we have already read about this, and nowadays we see our world is divided into first world countries, second world countries, developing countries, and developed countries. So we already know the countries who have the highest. I'm not talking about US. Okay, US does not is very low in the happiness index, or the index where the people are most happy, most contented, and most successful. Those are the European, Danish, Finland, Irish, those countries. Okay, so when we read about them, there's zero corruption, because there's no basic fight for energy or basic needs. Everyone gets whatever is there, the basic needs are fulfilled. Then they are not pressured into progressing too much, okay, for personal gains. They are made to work towards the betterment of the family as a whole, of a society or as a whole, and to enjoy and to evolve further. Okay, so that is the happiness index. You can search on Google and just think, why is it so? And in India and in US, these are the least happy countries, okay, in the world, and the least prosperous, mentally prosperous countries in the world. I'm not talking about financial economy, okay? I'm talking about the prosperity, the wealth, which is mental, physical, and financial as well. So obviously, jahan pe there's no basic needs are fulfilled, like some war-stricken countries where there's no, not enough food, not enough water, not enough, there's no housing to live in. There's too much of fighting for simple things, okay? And the countries where there's the basic needs are being taken care by the society and the, by the government, then obviously they do not know the basic struggle and they work towards the betterment of the society they are living in. From the above facts, we conclude that working for gaining of knowledge, which will help in gaining of daily bread, and working for a cause selflessly without any selfish interest can be called as diligent or broadly conscientious. Okay. So here sir has explained very, very beautifully what is conscientious and what is diligent. Diligent is basically hard work. So hard working without any self, if you're working too hard without taking care of your family, without taking care of your husband or wife, without taking into consideration what harm is it causing to the society or to the consumers you are dealing with, then that is not diligence. That has some psychosyphilitic aspect to it. But when you are working diligently for without any selfish interest, okay, you're working selflessly for the gaining of knowledge or for whatever purpose you feel you're born for, or you feel which is important to get that daily bread into your lives and to fulfill the basic requirements of your family, that is called conscientious. It has a predominantly Suric hue, okay? So diligent is basically hardworking without any selfless, selfish interest, and conscientious is also a thinking where you have to work for a cause without any selfish interest, okay? So the most important aspect is how we try to find out in a case whether a person is conscientious, diligent or not. If he has come to us, if it is a child, okay, you just have to, it is if he is or she is a small child, you just have to understand a basic thing ki hum log bahut zyada focus karte hain ki if a child is very studious, if a child is very obedient, if a child is very disciplined, we think that he or she is conscientious and diligent. We never try to find out what is the reason behind it. It can be that the parents are very disciplined, or the teachers are very disciplined and very dominating, dictatorial, okay? So because of fear or for appreciation, the child is doing whatever the parents are telling him to do, okay? So he is disciplined because his parents, his father, mother cannot tolerate indiscipline, cannot tolerate disobedience, okay? He does all his homework because either he has fear that his teacher or his parents will scold him or admonish him, or he or she is very ambitious and they cannot tolerate that someone else comes first before them. So they work constantly for that selfish gain of appreciation or for position or power or the ego, to satisfy their ego that they are the best ahead and nobody is near them. So those are not conscientious diligent. You will find children who will just say, the parents will be like, we never had to do anything to just 3 or 4 years old child. And we go much earlier. We try to ask the parents whether when the child started to hold objects, okay, did he try to hold a pen or a paper? He was more attracted towards a pen or paper or book or newspaper, and he tried to read and write alongside you without any pushing from your side, from the parent side? Or was he more interested in games and play and going outside and all that? So that is like whether that person is more interested in working selflessly, that is his genetic code, his or her. So this is the basic, okay? And then you can work upon more if there is an earlier. So this is the basic. Agar kisi parent ko yaad rehta hai ki unka bachcha was more inclined towards pen, paper, newspaper, books or something without any pushing from the parents, or he was more inclined towards toys and going outside and everything, and later when he started going to school or when the parents tried to teach him and then he started learning, okay? So that is not conscientious diligent, okay? Then when the child is in school level, preschool level, if he just loves to read, if he just loves to go to school, there can be hidden reasons also. He loves to go to school because he meets his friends, he's a social person, she's a social person. or he likes to, he's appreciated or she's appreciated there more. So you have to take, just take out these different reasons, rule out these different reasons, and then rule in how the patient is consensus decision or not. Okay, so this is, there should not be any selfish interest behind, either from the parents or from the person himself or herself. You can even ask in earlier, in the later years, when a patient comes to you, whether the person likes to work because he likes to work. So if the person is given a holiday, how does he try to, if they have holiday or weekends, how does the person try to, what does the person do in those weekends? Does he relax or he has the same routine, or is it the person doing something which is meaningful or something like that? We just have to rule out the different aspects to ascertain whether a person is diligent, conscientious or not. There can be that a person is non-conscientious and yet diligent. There can be the person is not conscientious and yet diligent. Not, okay, so that is later in rubrics. But usually it is conscientious, diligent, and non-conscientious and non-diligent, which is the basic of ruling out all the, or broadly differentiating the rubric, the medicines into two different parts. So diligently working for materialistic gains and greed and not for needs is psychotic and not soaring. Kiyosawa has said, there's diligently working, hardworking person who's working not for the needs. कि हाँ हार्ड वर्किंग करें करेंगे लेकिन इसलिए नहीं कि सिर्फ जो बेसिक नीड्स हम लोग की पूरी करें फॉर गेनिंग मोर एंड मोर एंड मोर एंड मोर ओके सो दैट इज नॉट डिलीजेंट दैट इज डिलीजेंट बट नॉट शोरिंग दैट इज साइकोटिक डिलीजेंसी ओवर वर्किंग अनकंट्रोल्ड डिजायर टू वर्क विदाउट केयरिंग फॉर लाइफ कैन बी सिफिलिटिक लाइक वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अर्लियर ऑल्सो He, a person can be non-conscientious and yet diligent. So here, sir is talking about the three miasmatic traits of diligence. A person who's diligently hard work, working or hard working for materialistic gains is not soaring, it is psychotic. For basic needs, it's soaring. For more gain, it is psychotic. And where the person is overworking, okay, which we call as workaholic, okay, can be psychotic or syphilitic. So where it is syphilitic, when he is not taking care of his life also. His desire to work is uncontrolled, where he is not taking care of his family, where he does not understand, he does not care whether that work is affecting his health, okay, or his life, that can be syphilitic. Needs of a cell or a man are sensed by his faculties. We have five faculties, five senses. And that can, so needs can be sensed by the five senses and the sense the dangers, all for the purpose of a better life. So the psychotic needs and the syphilitic needs are different. Sir has explained very beautifully here. So syphilis we'll be reading later. But the psychotic needs are different. The syphilitic needs are different. The soric needs are different. Okay, for a soric person, the needs we saw were bare minimums. Jo zarurat ka saman hota hai to sustain life. The man's needs are earning daily bread to provide energy. Okay, so our cell's need is oxygen, okay, glucose to provide ATP. So the daily, and the man's is ki bhai khana mile, we have a comfortable body to live in. We have a comfortable lifestyle. Okay, not lifestyle, that style, where the style comes, that is psychosis. A comfortable life, where there's sufficient for it. For everyone. So earning daily bread to provide energy, knowledge which ultimately helps him to earn bread and which also helps him to protect himself. So what are the two basic needs? One is protection and second is food. Okay, so jo knowledge, whatever knowledge the person is acquiring and whatever hard work the person is doing to acquire that knowledge which will help him to protect himself and his family and earn bread or food for him and his family as soric needs. Similarly, for a cell, the need is oxygen and nutrition, which will provide him energy. When the needs are at a premium, and that is when there's hypoxia or ischemia, when the demand is more and the supply is less. So if at a cellular level, there's less supply of oxygen and more of demand, okay, then there's hypoxia and ischemia when there's less of blood and more of demand. but the supply is less. So the cell will starve for it. Cell will crave for it, starve for it. उसको उसकी भूख लगी रहेगी, वो उसका nutrition complete नहीं हुआ. It if it it wants it, the cell wants the food and the oxygen, but does not get it. The senses are increased, so the senses will get heightened, increased. So the least amount of oxygen. क्यों heightened होंगे वो senses? कि वो एक तरीके से relay transmitters हैं ना, those are signal receptors, senses. तो जहां भी कहीं भी थोड़ा सा ऑक्सीजन मिल जाए, कहीं भी थोड़ा सा उनको ब्लड मिल जा रहा है, तो दे जस्ट बिकम एक्टिव. तो वो सेंसेस का हाइटन होना जरूरी है. ओके, सो ये डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म है. व्हेन देयर स्टार्वेशन, सो द लीस्ट अमाउंट ऑफ ऑक्सीजन इज नाउ वेलकम. इट इज समथिंग लाइक अ गर्ल. सर हैज गिवन एन एग्जांपल. इट इज समथिंग लाइक अ गर्ल हुज नीड्स आर अप्रिसिएशन. ओके, सो अप्रिसिएशन इज ब्रेड एंड बटर. आई कैन इज ब्रेड एंड बटर. Appreciation is bread and butter. If her needs are not met with that, is she does not get appreciation to her satisfaction. Okay? Automatically, she increases in sensitivity as if to search for the most minimum sympathy available. So here, sir compares, first tells about the starvation at cellular level and the starvation then at mental level or a constitution level. So the senses are heightened. So jabhi I think I remembered something. Whenever we are taking a case taking, why the five senses, there is a case taking may the five senses are really important. Okay, and we whether the person's smell has the sense of smell is increased, ki baakiyon ko nahi samajh mein aata, the person's sense of smell is very acute, the sense of hearing is very acute, the taste buds are really acute. Okay, or sight or the touch, he is really receptive to the touch. Either there's want of magnetism, too much of clinginess, or lack of it. He does not want any consolation, she does not want any consolation, he does not want any physical hugging or kissing and everything. These are heightened sensitivities, either towards less or high. These are defense. So these are important. That kai baar hota hai ki the person comes into hidden psychosis or hidden psychosyphilitic trait. So when we these are syphilitic symptoms. Whenever the person's senses are heightened, these are psychotic, moving towards syphilitic symptoms. So we take these into consideration, and during follow up, these senses should be going back to better. अगर उनका अक्यूट स्मेल है तो दैट शुड बी गोइंग बैक टू बेटर. देयर सम डिस्गस्टिंग की बाकियों को वो स्मेल नहीं आता. देयर सम डिस्गस्ट टुवर्ड्स डर्ट और समथिंग, दैट शुड गेट बैक टू बेटर. हियरिंग शुड गेट बैक टू सोरिक लेवल्स और सो मतलब इट शुड गेट बी गेटिंग बैक टू नॉर्मल. ओके, द टच ईदर द क्लिंगीनेस और मैग्नेटिज्म इंक्रीज, मैग्नेटिज्म शुड डिक्रीज, और द अवर्जन टू टच और अवर्जन टू कॉन्सोलेशन शुड डिक्रीज. ओके, सो दिस इज अ बेसिक थिंग आई रिमेम्बर. So here, sir, has at a constitution level, a mental constitution level, what are the needs? The basic needs when a child is born or when he is or she is in pregnancy, in vitro also, in utero also, that the basic needs are love, okay, appreciation, support, basic love and care. The child requires food. It requires for the physical well-being, but it requires love, affection, basic care, sense of satisfaction, sense of security as a basic need at a mental level. So when a child, it does not get enough appreciation, obviously he or she is starving for it, the need is not fulfilled. So the demand is more and supply is really less. The parents do not give it due to some of the other reasons. Okay, so obviously वो जब उसके satisfaction के level का नहीं होगा, the senses will increase, so the person will develop sensitivity towards appreciation. Okay, the sensitivity will increase, so जहाँ भी थोड़ी सी sympathy मिल जाएगी, जहाँ भी थोड़ा सा minimum something will she'll get, she'll automatically be attracted towards that source. Okay, this rise of senses and sensitivity is not selective but collective. What does that mean? So sir has explained so she becomes sensitive to hurt. Your need is appreciation, the child's need is appreciation. So when the child does not get appreciation, then obviously what are the different sensitive areas. Okay, she'll be very sensitive to hurt. She or he will be very sensitive to reprimands, means datana, neglect, tiraskar. Okay, as well as pains. Okay, mana ya pains. Or if she or he is ill, agar ek normal child hai jiska childhood bahut acha gaya hai aur usko appreciation mila hai, to agar that child becomes hurt physically, or there's injury, or there's illness, fever or something, that child will not crave so much for attention and affection and appreciation, and will not mourn so much for, and will not feel the pain or the inner turmoil so much. हम लोग कई बार नोटिस करते होंगे कि हम लोग क्या घर में दो बच्चे हैं और एक को वही फीवर है, वही सब बॉडी एक है, सब कुछ है, लेकिन एक को कुछ ज्यादा ही पेन फील होता है, एक को कुछ ज्यादा ही होता है, और दूसरा रिलैक्स कि हाँ मेरे को पेन है या मेरे को फीवर है, बट आई विल गेट बेटर. ओके, सो दिस इज हियर वी कैन डिफरेंशिएट दैट विच चाइल्ड हैज गॉटन सफिशिएंट अप्रिसिएशन एंड लव एंड केयर एंड द नीड्स व्हिच वर रिक्वायर्ड, एंड विच चाइल्ड हैज बीन डेफिशिएंट इन गेटिंग ऑल दिस. ओके, this is a state of hypersensitivity. So soric hypersensitivity is controlled. Here the hypersensitivity is there, but it is controlled, and differs from syphilitic hypersensitivity, that is uncontrolled. Anything which goes into syphilis is uncontrolled, but because it is the last defense mechanism which is meant to destroy, or which has gone out of control. Okay, so any hypersensitivity which is not in excessive clinging, excessive crying, excessive moaning, that comes in syphilis. We can take that in acute also, as well as in chronic conditions also. That defines the constitution of the person and what phase of the miasm he or she is in. Okay, so body always speaks the mind's language. Body and mind are not two different things, but two poles of the same axis. Thus the sensitivity is increased also at the body level, when anything which happens in the mind is reflected in the body. Okay, so and to give rise to pain factor. So ye hum logon ne kai baar suna hoga ki kai, I've heard in my practice, I've seen in my practice that many a times parents come or people come and they compare between their two kids and they tell ki ye jo hai ye to usko zara si chot lag jati hai to he is very ki mamma blood nikal aaya. Yeah, even I've seen that in older matlab adults, that a little cut will cause them to have too much of anxiety and too much of apprehension, and they'll show it to everyone. And in some people, too much of blood also and severe injury also will not give so much of reaction. So there can be two things. Here, sir is talking about the basic needs. So, but there can also be one more thing, that maybe the defense mechanism has gone into psychosis less. That there's too much of blood, but the patient is not showing any reaction. So that can be that due to neglect or extreme dominating dictatorial disciplined environment, the person is not allowed to show his emotions. So that has become his trait. That has become his character. So we'll have to judge that also later. We'll come to that later in psychotic. But here the soric pains are controlled. The sense and the pain factor is essentially soric. So hypersensitivity of body level can give rise to allergies and hypersensitivities. Thus rhinitis, anything which has itis, that means basic inflammation. So the five signs of basic inflammation are all soric. So thus rhinitis, bronchitis, asthmas caused by sensitivity to fire, dust, pollen, cold air, or change of temperatures, or any food articles which commonly go under the term allergies, are increased sensitivities and are purely soric defense. Okay, when a skin is scraped or scalded, the upper protective layer is no more present, so the exposed skin is now sensitive not only to sharp pointed metallic things, but become sensitive to even a silk cloth or cotton piece. Matlab jo hard cheeze hain wo to hum log ko affect karengi when the skin is scraped or scalded or is injured and the upper protective layer is not there and we are exposed internally, then obviously the hard things will obviously injure us, but even the soft things will also tend to injure us. So similarly, a sensitive mind starts getting hurt and offended very easily by matters of jokes, reprimands and rudeness, which otherwise would have gone unfelt and unnoticed. So we see in our circles also that many a times you'll have some friends or some relatives, you'll find different reactions in different people. Okay, so some people will be very sensitive to reprimands or even in matter of jokes, some people will be very sensitive to what jokes are cracked on them or how they are perceived by their peers or by the society or by their families. And they are very conscious, they get hurt really easily. So we have to understand ki jahan bhi zyada sensitivity hai, that means wahan pe the person hota hai na ki there's a land, piece of land which has no water, there is drought. So even a drop of water will matter. But in a land which is full of water, get sufficient water supply, the fertile soil is there, then it doesn't matter if there's a downpour or not for next 2 months or not. So obviously same thing in people, in a person who has sufficient needs, he got appreciation, he got love. So there, he'll not be easily hurt or offended by jokes or reprimands or rudeness. But in a person where you will find the person is very sensitive to rudeness or jokes or reprimands, that means that there he or she did not get enough love or affection or appreciation. Okay, so typical soric mind therefore is very conscientious, sensitive, offended easily, weeps easily, and to defend itself from all this, it shirks away from hurt. It gets away, it tries to hide itself, get away from hurt, withdraws from hurt. Withdrawal or timidity, what we say is timidity is or withdrawal is a reaction to the sensitive. Okay, so these are all reactions that the person will get very offended easily. The reaction will be he'll be weeping easily. He'll try to defend itself from all the hurt that is possible. He'll just withdraw from the hurt. So what are the possible things which will happen? Anticipation will be there. Apprehension will be there. See, anxiety, anticipation, apprehension, these are all soric traits. What will happen in psychosis, it will shift, it will be fear. So, and what will happen in syphilis, there will be anguish. Okay, so here, anticipation, apprehension, anxiety, it is better that I do not, what is the person thinking in anticipation, anxiety, apprehension? It is better that I do not go to the extent where I might get hurt. So there's inhibition, there's withdrawal. He's thinking about it. Anxiety is there. This state gives a mental picture of timidity, anxiousness, carefulness, going into a shell, finding a cover, like I'll carry a card, inhibition. Inhibition, apprehension, and anticipatory anxiety, etc. These are the rubrics, these are the mental traits of a soric or soropsychotic, soric mental. So the crux of soric mental plus physical defense of sora. So the soric mentals will revolve around sensitivity, anxiety, timidity, irritability, anger, etc. And the soric physicals will revolve around fever, diarrhea, pain, inflammation. Okay, all this time the cell was fighting a lone battle. The cell was fighting alone with a hostile stimulus, with an enemy stimulus, purely using physiological defense. Sora is always physiological. Whenever the gear shifts to pathological, either physical or mental, then that the gear has been shifted to psychosis. Okay, the physiological defense is the first primary defense. We have read that earlier also, and every being has to go through it. It is worthwhile remembering that cell adopts the secondary defense only when the primary physiological defense has failed. So whenever a person or a body or mind has shifted its defense to psychotic miasm, that means the soric miasm was not enough to protect it. Okay, so we have to understand that. It is worthwhile remembering that cell adopts the secondary defense only when the primary physiological defense has failed. The secondary defense is by bringing about structural changes, and it is called morphological defense. We have read that earlier also. So it can be, it will be structural multiplication, morphological changes. Okay. After the first defense, the organism is not bound to go to the secondary defenses. We always think in our minds, even I thought in our college days, that the miasm shift in a person by sora, psychosis, and syphilis, or sora, syphilis, psychosis, or like that. but it is not necessary. A person who's in psoriatic phase can directly shift to syphilis. The secondary defense mechanism, as the books of pathology tell us, totally depends upon the genetic code of the individual organism. Okay. So if an individual has genetically acquired from his parents or acquired through syphilitic infection, there can be syphilitic infection or from genetically from the parents. If the parents were in syphilitic mode, they were predominantly into syphilis, or during pregnancy, during conception, the meiosis under which the person's the cell, the embryo was nurtured was psychosyphilis, then the person will shift into syphilis. Okay. So then after the pregnancy, the base is always sore. The body will always go into the first line of defense. There can never be that a person is born with totally psychosyphilis. The base has to be there. So sore will always be present. But according to the person's genetic code, according to the infections or the whatever he's acquired, according to that, the person will shift the gear directly to syphilis or follow the path of sore, psychosis, and syphilis. Okay. So the primary physiological defense, which is sore, then the individual organism and its cells resort to syphilitic or destructive pathology as a response to the continued hostile stimulus. Thus, in these cases, sore. Sora, which has to be present as a base, is followed by syphilis as a secondary defense. So I told that earlier, that in the cases where the meiosis, which syphilitic meiosis, syphilitic traits were inherited either through the parents or through infection or or through the environment he acquired from that. So the person here in these cases, sora, which is the base. Okay, after that, it will be followed by syphilis as a secondary defense. Okay. On the other hand, the individual who has inherited the constructive element from his parents, constructive means psychotic elements from his parents, or even acquired it during lifetime, it can either be genetic or it can be acquired in the life. Okay. In the form of venereal disease, gonorrhea, will resort to constructive pathology as response to the continued hostile stimulus. So a constitution which uses constructive pathology more often and more easily due to the inherited or acquired trait in the genes is psychotic constitution. Okay. So anything, a constitution who's using more of constructive pathology, either physically or you will find more of psychotic mental traits in the patient, that means that person has shifted to psychotic phenomena, that is a psychotic constitution. The base will always be sore. Okay. The constitution, because the constitution which uses destructive pathology easily and predominantly is syphilitic constitution. Okay. In cases where both psychosis and syphilis have been inherited, say for example, psychosis from mother and syphilis, psychosis from father and syphilis from mother, then the one which is dominant and the genes which are activated will determine the pathology or the uppermost meiosis at that particular time. Okay, so we've already seen in many a times, so we understand this very well, ki in a person where the person has inherited both the meiosis from either of his parents, say for example, psychosis from during the time of conception, the father was more into psychotic meiosis and the mother was more into syphilitic meiosis. Okay, so he inherited psychosis from his father and syphilis from his mother. So he'll have a psychosyphilitic combination, okay? But the meiosis, which will be predominantly active, which will show itself, will be the dominant, the dominant genes which are activated, okay? So jahan pe the whichever genes which are dominant, though that meiosis will get activated. So for example, if the father's genes are dominant, so the father's psychotic trait will get activated and the mother's syphilitic trait will remain regressed or suppressed. Okay, so if syphilis is the dominant trait, then this child can suffer from destructive pathologies. Example, you'll find that in the child. Nose osnea, caries or nasal cartilage or retinal degeneration, caries, destructive pathologies will happen at a young age. This could later on switch to psychosis or constructive defense pathologies as well. Later on, it might happen that a person has is predominantly into syphilitic phase, okay? But later on, the psychotic phase might also catch up and the patient might show psychotic pathologies also, like warts, excrescences, polyps, even a brain tumor, okay? So in another child, it could be exactly opposite, okay? In another child, it could be like that the child was predominantly psychotic and later syphilis creeped in. Both were inherited by the parents. But all said and done, every cell has to use the primary response or physiological response defense before either going to any of the secondary responses. So SORA has to be the fundamentalism before psychosis or syphilis can come in. And that is the truth, ultimate truth. So there can be no psychosis, no syphilis without SORA. Now let's move on to psychotic methods. So here, why psychosis is really important to understand what the phase the patient is coming in, to break through the psychosis and to understand what not to take in the case taking. We have to take psychotic mentals when the patient is coming in soropsychotic mism or in a phase where he is predominantly psychotic. But if the person is coming with syphilitic traits, with syphilitic diseases, the psychosyphilitic traits, and we find some syphilitic traits in mentals or physicals, then we have to rule out the psychotic traits. Okay, so these are important. To assess the mental picture of psychosis, it is worthwhile recollecting the physical aspects of psychosis. We deduced earlier that some organisms that fail to stop the irritating hostile factors by physiological defense adopt a more solid approach, that is of fortification. Construction. Okay, let us for the timing assume the cell state of the cell or a thought process in a cell as if it were a human being. The primary response of physiological defense response of the cell is expressed as sensitivity, irritability, pain, inflammation at the physical plane, and sensitivity, irritability, anxiety, anger, insecurity, and mental thing. We have discussed that earlier also. So as the hostile stimulus continues, the cell could start feeling insecure and a sense of frailness could set us in. What is the purpose of the defense mechanism? To fight with the hostile stimulus and to maintain again the balance back to normal. Okay. So if with the primary defense mechanism, the body is not able to fight and the body, the mind is not able to fight and the circumstance is not normal, then it shifts the gear to secondary mechanism so that it can fight further. So now, earlier it was anxiety, insecurity. Now there's feeling of fear. So the cell could continue, could start feeling insecure and a sense of frailness could send it. Frailness basically is weakness. So now there is an impeding fear of being finished or destroyed. Now the pehle to ek there was a sense ki 50-50 condition, there was anxiety and apprehension that I can win also and I can lose also, let's try. Now there now it is, the fear is taking power over it, overpowering us. Okay, so the what is the fear? The basic fear for any cell, for any organism, for us as energy is death. The ultimate fear is death, that we will perish, we will not exist anymore. Okay, that an impeding fear of death accompanies this fragile cell, weakened by sustained hostility, unable to overcome the enemy in man-to-man combat, tries to adopt gorilla technique, gorilla tactics. Those whose genes have cowardice traits try to adopt the constructive defense. Okay, so we have earlier discussed also the syphilis is more of uncontrolled destructive mechanism. So whenever we find, what is the second mechanism? That is psychosis, that is construction. So a construction comes, the base is fear. So by fear, there's cowardice. And in cowardice, the cell or the mind or the constitution is trying to protect itself, okay? So constructive defense is there. The cell would like to deceive the invader. Okay, so the cell would like to manipulate, deceive the invader. It tries to cover up, it tries to hide itself, up its weakness by fortification. It builds a wall behind which it can hide. The wall needs accumulations of certain things or multiplication of certain things. Once this wall is ready outside the cell, the false facade has been created. The enemy needs to penetrate this false facade wall if it has to attack the interior of the cell, okay? In order to put off the invader, the cell's mind uses all the guiles and tricks, each and every trick, to manipulate, deceive, create falsehood, try to hide itself, okay? It may put on a show to make itself foppish, to hide, and project what it is not. This false projection of exterior not reflecting the interior is a part of the shrewd, sly maneuvering tactics of for self-defense. Okay, so what does here it is very clear, psychosis is a phase where the cell, where the person, okay, is trying to hide its original characters, okay? So when the person comes, and you are trying to do probe its mentals, okay? So whenever a person who is coming to you with a psychotic or soropsychotic or psychosyphilitic disease, then be very sure, or in that phase of life, like he's 20, 25, 30 years, 40 years of age, so that is the phase of psychosis. The soric phase has gone by, okay? So you have to be very careful, because here, the patient who has obviously come to us now because he wants to get cured, but his defense mechanism is subconscious. It is unconscious. It is not in his control. Okay. So obviously he'll try to project whatever projection of the constitution you are seeing in front of you. That is all a deceit. That is all there to deceive you. And if you believe the constitution which is sitting in front of you, then the constitution will be successful in manipulating you as well, and will get diverted from your path, from your chain of thought, and go to a different remedy, to a different constitution. For example, whenever Pulsatilla comes to you, whenever we'll not take names of the medicines, whenever a constitution comes to you who's trying, when you're talking to that person and you feel wah kitni bechari, or you feel kitna iske saath galat hua, yeah, you feel she is so rebellious, whatever good traits you think of, ki jo bhi aapko first picture milti hai na, jo aapko wo energy wo transmit ho rahi hai, that is not the original picture. That is what the patient is trying to portray himself. How the patient is trying to portray himself. So you have to break through that psychosis. If a most of the times when I get patients, they try to portray themselves as very conscientious, very diligent, in any case, okay, very hardworking, very emotional, sometimes very emotional, very disciplined. Ki main to sab kuch acha karta hu, mere saath kuch acha nahi hota hai. Yeah, I'm very bechar, ghar mein mere saath sab kharab hota hai, ya society mere saath acha nahi karti, or very rebellious. It can be the person is really rebellious, or it can be the person is a leader or an administrator, but it can also be that the person is just trying to portray that image onto yourself so that he can hide his internal, her internal nature. That is the primary defense mechanism, that is psychosis. So we need to break that psychosis, okay? So we need to understand that how that this defense mechanism works, okay? So that is an accumulation. So here, the false facade, which and the person will be sly, will be deceptive, will be manipulative. Every person will be like that. Recently, I read in autism and everywhere, we try to find out the different milestones of the patient, okay? How the patient is growing in different milestones. So a basic milestone, a mental milestone in a child is in 3, 4 years or 5 years, is if a patient, if a child who has normal milestones, who has developed intellect, okay, who has developed logic, who has normal growth pattern of mind, will know how to tell a lie, will know how to deceive his parents, will know how to get manipulate and get out of the situation, or get whatever he wants. These are basic mental milestones which are considered the normal if the patient or if a child is growing normally. So whenever a parent comes to us and they come with a child, so they try to tell, nahi ye to bahut obedient hai, nahi ye to bahut maan manta hai, nahi ye to bilkul jhoot nahi bolta hai, nahi to isne to kuch bhi nahi kiya. And agar wo us phase ka hai ki 3 or 8 years ka hai, and you are trying to probe, because that is the basic milestone which has to be achieved if the person is developing in his intellect or his mind is developing in that particular manner, in a normal growth pattern. So it is very important. This is the psychological basis. It is very important that your child knows by 3 or 4 how to tell a lie, how to deceive or manipulate the parent or surroundings for affection or for whatever he needs. So basically, the child needs only affection, gratification. So the parent try to say, nahi, ye bahut achha hai. So we need to be very cautious. Hum logo turant alert hoke case taking lena chahiye. That nahi, kya usne kabhi jhoot nahi bola, kya aap logon ko kabhi manipulate nahi kiya ki main mamma ka bachcha hoon, kya main papa ka bachcha hoon, ya kabhi usne apni cheezon ke liye manipulate nahi kiya. That is manipulation ka matlab ye hota hai, the child is able to take into consideration his environment. He is grasping the basic complexities of the physical and the emotional environment of the human being and trying to evolve for his survival. Okay, so we need to take that. And this is one of the things in case autism which we I consider. Okay, so that this should come back. Okay, in MRCP, it can also be that this is the animal trait. So that is always there. So this is psychotic mechanism. And this has to be there for a person to successfully build his psychotic defense mechanism. Okay, so painlessness. There's another trait, which is painlessness of complaints. So painlessness of complaints, which are otherwise painful, is a classical example of such tactic. The patient is feeling too much of pain. That is there. Okay, but the patient will, for his selfish motives, for the gratification of his urges, for protecting himself, he'll not complain of the pain. Because he will not show that, try to show that he is in pain, but he is in pain. So that painlessness is also one of the tactics. All this it does shamelessly. This cowardice, fragility, fear, hiding, cover up, projection, facade, thick skin, hoarding, accumulations of money, property, treasure, showmanship, cunningness, slyness, shrewdness, maneuvering, political shamelessness, selfishness, self-centeredness, etc. are some of the rubrics which can describe the psychotic mentality. Now, I want to just discuss one more thing. See, we as human beings are very sensitive, okay? Because our Sora has gone by. I'm talking to all the homeopaths and all of you people. So, see, we try to think of psychotic rubrics as very bad, okay? So we try to think that if we are fragile, if we have fears, if we are hiding, if we have cowardice, cowardice is what we discussed earlier. It is the reaction or defense mechanism due to fear. We are trying to cover up. So 99% of us are into the psychotic phenomena. Okay. So first we should try to analyze ourselves, and then only we can truly analyze the other person sitting in front of us. Okay. And this will really help us at mental level to understand And this happens to everyone. We are, this is the way of life, okay, the circle of life. From Sora, we are going into psychosis, and some of us are into psychosyphilis, and then we'll go to syphilis, okay? So, but this should happen according to the age. So if we are in at this age and we are still trying to project, or we are in our mental, we have this prejudice, like psychotic or sabko Sora mein rehna chahiye or psychosis, and this is not, is bad. Then we'll not be able to take a case taking or properly, or we'll not be able to analyze a person sitting in front of us properly, because we'll be prejudiced towards that person. Okay, so please, before being a good homeopath, please try to be a better human being, not being by not trying to cover yourself. Just be true to yourself, what you are. So try to analyze yourself, and then try to reduce that false presumptions or prejudice against these rubrics. These are just defense mechanisms which occur in every human being. Okay, so these are the rubrics which, and this will, this is due to some of the other soric sensitivities, soric deficiencies which we have all gone through. And because of that, we have all shifted our mechanisms to the next phase, just to defend ourselves. Okay, so we need to understand what are the different sensitivities which were hurting us, due to which we have shifted our gear to this, and then we'll be able to analyze the different. This was a way in which I tried to analyze myself, and then I could understand the other person, how he can betray himself and me in a case taking. So whenever I would try to project myself as this happened to me because of a certain phenomena, then I would try to analyze the reactions which I used to do. Okay, so due to this, those reaction, I could understand, okay, these reactions when given by a different constitution can be that those are not true reaction, and there can be a hidden reason behind it. There can be hidden reason behind it. So this helps us in tracing back the origin to Sora, finding out the basic constitution and understanding the defense mechanism the person is in, and then understanding the syphilitic trait either he's going into or he is already into. So this is the psychosis which So cunningness, as I told you earlier also, lying or manipulating, this comes as early as a milestone as 3 to 5 years of age. Okay, so these are only one of the milestones. Okay, but if it goes to next level, that the person is stealing or the person is lying without any compulsion on a child, so then we have to look into it. Okay, the first phase of psychosis excess. This phase of psychosis gives rise to overgrowing, overfunctioning, overworking, okay, over trying to please others, over trying to talk, like being over talkative, trying to portray a personality which is too flashy, which is over flashy, which is over show off to others. Okay, it is just psychosis excess. That is just a person's defense mechanism. Okay, it causes overexpression and overprojection. These, when applied, right now, most of the world is in psychosis excess and psychosyphilitic excess. These, when applied to expression, will, intellect, emotions, morals, etc., will give us the psychotic excess traits. So here, sir will now be talking about the different words that he has used here. And these are very important, the most important in our case taking. We have to analyze whether a person, how's the person's expression, what is the need, what is the sensitivity, what is the reaction, what will be the will, what is the intellect, how are his emotions, okay, what are his morals. Then only we can come to a conclusion that what is the constitution and what rubrics do we have to take. Okay, so over expressive, this quality makes a person loquacious, talkative, expansive, communicative. These people who are extrovert go on talking and talking. They answer any question, never in one word, nor in one sentence. The classic examples are sulfurs, lachesis. We know these are the first remedies which comes to our mind. But believe me, these are not the only remedies when you type loquacious, okay, as a rubric. There are many remedies. So try to understand the trait the expressions of psychosis. And then you will be able to understand what rubrics to take and how to come to a medicine. Okay, just do not be prejudiced over 4 to 5 remedies and then just try to fit every person in those categories. They answer any question never in one word nor in one sentence. They are good patients for homeopathic history. They are really good patients for homeopathic history, but many a times it might happen that we are just lost in their psychosis. Okay, and they're taking us to a different level altogether, and we are just lost there. And 1.5 hour goes and 2 hours goes, and we are not able to understand. Kya ye 3 ghanta to baat ho gayi, but nikalna kya tha? Unhone bata kya diya? So we have to bring that patient back to our train of thought. Okay. They answer any question never in one word nor in one sentence. They are good patients for homeopathic history. When asked what is wrong, with you or what is your chief complaint, they'll start the narration right from their childhood. A man who just wanted to give a news that his wife, he's given an example that his wife has aborted. Okay, so the person will start narrating right from the time he came from work, and then they had their food, and then they went for a long walk, and then they ate some ice cream, and then they took a detour, matlab shortcut from a market to a park and residence, and where they went and what they ate and what they talked, and then suddenly there was a spasm, and then the patient was sent to a hospital, and there she aborted. So some loquacious talkative people while narrating topic may lose their thread and go to another topic. This can also happen. Okay, some of the patients who try to impress upon the importance of their complaints, they over exaggerate. This happens a lot in your follow-ups. Okay, the patient thinks that if I exaggerate my follow-up that my complaints are not better, then ma'am or sir, the doctor will give me some good remedy, okay, or more remedies, and then I'll be better. So we have to be very, very strict with our and very persistent with our follow-ups also. That in these kind of type of cases, whenever a patient is coming to you and still saying ki, and you are very sure that the remedy was right, and still saying, nahi ma'am, koi farak nahi pada, nahi sir, koi farak nahi pada, nahi ye bhi hai, ye bhi hai. And then you have to be very sure and break the person again and again and repeat and be very sure that nahi, the patient is better or not. And then only change your remedy or wait. My simple advice will be wait for some time. If you want to truly give and find results, do not change remedies again and again. Because the common perception in a psychotic patient will be that if I exaggerate, okay, or I talk in vivacious language, then the doctor will understand me better. So they might be able to, they might land up giving you symptoms which are more exaggerated than what they actually are. Okay, or in the case taking itself, or they might end up giving you a wrong follow-up altogether. Okay, and you in a haste or hurry or in anxiety and panic, you might change your remedy altogether. So this is very important in case taking also and in follow-ups also. So people who talk very vivaciously with flowery language, who are very eloquent, very well-mannered in their speech, like it says opium, who are flatterers, or who talk about money, making money, or about luxuries, amusements, rather than the daily needs and necessities, tend to have psychosis traits. So we are all into psychosis, one way or the other. This is a natural phenomenon. The only thing we can do is try to restrict ourselves ill traits, negative traits of psychosis, if we are consciously going into that, like more of money accumulation. So we as homeopaths, because we know that this is a dominant trait in us, we can just sit silently, just look, introspect, okay, just look into our minds, just analyze ourselves. Why do we want more money? Why do we talk lie so much? Why are we exaggerating things too much? Why do we want people to appreciate us so much? And then we can go back and back and just land to the soric necessity, which was deficient in us and which we felt was not need, which was not given enough. And that led to this defense mechanism. And we can just try and analyze it rationally and move towards the higher purpose of life. So this is one of the psychotic traits. The other thing is will. Okay, so what we talked about is over-expressiveness. Here, sir is talking about the psychosis excess. Under-expressiveness is also a thing where the person here, when the person was talking about abortion, he went on and on and on. So in under-expressing, person will just tell in one word or one sentence that, sir, my wife aborted. They are under-expressive. And they are, can be under-expressive because of many reasons, that there was no one to listen to them, or they were brought up in a very strict, dominating, dictatorial family or society or schooling, or there was a lot of neglect altogether, or destructive or domestic abuse, many things. So we have to get into that. So these are important. Okay. Will, through psychosis itself, is, though psychosis itself is based on cowardice and fear of death, the ideal, we think cowardice is a very bad trait. Huh? Someone who's a coward, or someone who's not, who's fearful, is a very bad trait. But can you tell me, like, every person, every one of us are scared or coward in one or the other aspects of life. We can either be scared for us, or we can be scared for our children, or we can be scared for our families. So cowardice is a defense mechanism which helps us to remain in psychosis and be alive and not go into syphilis and destroy either ourselves or others. Okay, so this is a good trait if in a minimum, it helps in a minimum. It helps us to be ourselves, to sustain ourselves. Okay, this is a psychotic. So though psychosis itself is based on cowardice and fear of death, the ideal psychotic excess personality shall project himself as a dictator. Okay, so all those dominating dictatorial people can have the base of Sora, okay, or the base of psychosis as fear. And when we go further, we find out what was the anxiety, insecurity, what was the reason in Sora, because of which they shifted their mechanism, and their reaction is as a dictator. The dominance is more pronounced where there is least resistance or opposition. So there's this rubric, hard on inferiors and soft with superiors, where we know lycopodium is there. Okay, so three or four remedies are there in this rubric. So the dominance is more pronounced where there's least resistance or opposition. These individuals can rule in a home or dominate in office only on subordinates. They are meek in front of the boss. Children, often we'll see the children who are defiant, who are very ziddi, na? They are very aggressive, they are defiant and obstinate, ziddi, and throw tantrums in front of mothers, parents, family members. Who they know, jinko they know na ki they will not hurt me. They are in a very nourished environment, very caring, pampered environment. They will not know. You'll find parents will come to you ki, ma'am, ye ghar mein to bahut sher banta hai, bahar bhi ye billi ban ke chala aata hai. Ye bahar ladta hi nahi hai, ghar mein to ye sabse ladai karta hai, kisi ki baat hi nahi sunta. School mein koi isko maar deta hai to rote hue chala aata hai. Theek hai. So these are people who are more realize at home, they'll know nobody will hurt them at home. So they show their true character at home, that they are very defiant and obstinate and throw tantrums, and but become very timid when they are outside, or when the father returns home, or when they go to school or a neighbor's house, belong to this group, okay, to this group of hard or inferiors and soft with superiors. Be very mindful when you take case taking in children, okay, because these you have to focus on this rubric, but because this is a very small rubric, okay, where there are some remedies only, so always try to take a rubric which has more remedies. So it will help you a lot in differentiating. Okay, do not avoid taking rubrics which have got small number of remedies, because that will just be selective. Sir and senior homeopaths who have been practicing since a lot of years take small rubrics because they knew the basic constitution, they knew okay what had to be taken. And but when you are starting, just try to consider rubrics which are broad, okay, which have more medicines in them. Okay, so children, this is one of the example which sir has given of. which sir has given of children who might come into the rubric of hard or inferiors and soft with superiors. Okay, so for the child knows that for them, mother and grandparents or a maid is someone who's taken for granted. The child knows these people with whom he spends most of the time as very harmless. They will not harm. So he is very confident in his surrounding and he'll just dominate. Okay. These are the people who give him love and never mean him harm. He has nothing to fear for them. He has got the optimum environment. And therefore can, so jo optimum environment hai, usme he is showing his true character. Therefore can dictate terms with him. The father who is not present throughout the day is taken as an outsider. He may be harmful to the child. The child does not know. As would be a boss in an office. In adults, it is a boss or a teacher in a school. Such people could be potential harmful for the child. So in front of them, the child who is devil at home could become a meek, timid entity. Such may be the psychotic variations of lachesis, lycoveratrum, platina. These are the remedies which are in this rubric. Okay. So sir has very beautifully explained this rubric. And more, you have to focus more on the explanation which sir has given of psychosis. Okay, how the will behaves in a person. Do not focus only on this rubric. There are many other rubrics, okay, through which will is defined in a person. So this is a way in which sir has asked us to just analyze how a person is and why is he like that, okay? Psychosis, excess personality is an achiever. Okay. His desires are more than his needs. Okay. So because the patient has shifted his gear to psychosis. So he needs more than he desires. He desires more than he needs. His desires, unki jo abhilashaye, unki jo akanshaye, wo badh chuki hai. Now it is not about the needs. It is not about the basic necessity for life to survive. Okay, it is about accumulating. So obviously, a person who is an achiever, that we talk na ki jo hum log sote hain ki jo bachcha hamesha first aata hai, jo hamesha obedient rehta hai, so that is basically a psychotic phenomenon. Na, it is we have to be very conscious when we are trying to distinguish. Put a person in a bracket whether he is conscientious diligent or non-conscientious non-diligent. So do not ever be misguided into thinking that the person who is achiever, who's into everyone's good books, cannot be non-conscientious non-diligent. He can be non-conscientious non-diligent or non-conscientious yet diligent because he is an achiever. He wants to achieve. He desires more than he needs. So that is the greed for which he's working hard. Okay. Desires more than he needs. Another rubric sir has given in which there is arsenic, salt, flavum, baryta, salts are in there. Okay. We tend to neglect barytas a lot. We think they are just there's a lot of prejudice and presumptions and the whatever I was talking about baryatas. Baryatas can be great achievers. They can be toppers in their classes. They can be very hardworking. They can be the best in the societies. Okay, so just read sir's book. Sir has written in detail about calcareas, baryatas, different minerals and genetic materia medica. If you not have it, just buy it through the app. And it is a must. Sir's books are Extroverts and Introverts is another book. These are must if you want to really practice practically and want to get good results by understanding the constitution of the person. And believe me, whatever books you might have read about, whatever Materia Medica or whatever old books of Stalwarts, okay, these are the most basic, most simplest, the best explanations which we could have gotten to understand a particular constitution or a particular remedy or why or he or she behaves in a certain manner. Sir has absolutely delivered the best of the best books in the most simplest of manners for every homeopathic student to understand. Okay, so just go through that. These helped me a lot till date. Okay, I'm still learning so much from all his books, because every time we read it, as I told earlier, I get some of the other things which are helpful, even in like when I might have read it like 5 or 6 or 10 times or 15 times, but yet it helps me. Okay. So Baraita, self, Brainia, okay. Zinc, he desires money, success, name, and fame. So anyone who is desiring anywhere, there's desire more than the need, there's desire. Okay, there's a greed. For it can be the money, it can be the success, name, fame, anything. That is psychosis. There may be avarice, greed, gluttony. Okay, he pursues gluttony when overeating or desire for food and gluttony, overeating. He pursues these desires with obstinacy and positivity. So when in achievers, there'll be you'll often find that achievers are very defined, very strong-willed. Okay, they are ziddi, bachche ziddi honge. They'll be positive in their endeavors. They will be positive in their mindset. So that is psychosis. That is, for achievement, he may use any means. Okay, or morals. This is just an example. Early means of morals. Behind this achieving tendency is a greed or a selfish interest. So many patients, many homeopaths I find, they are very, very lenient in giving metals. Okay, so please, before giving metals, now try to find out very, very, very sharply and observe very sharply whether the person's achievements or his morals are due to because he's conscientious, diligent, or there's some innate, hidden greed or desires which has been inculcated in him since his childhood also. Nowadays, we are finding children who have been trained in a particular manner by the parents only. That the parents, jo bhi wo nahin kar paaya, jo bhi unko lagta hai ki the way the person should be, my child should be projected in society. They start working on their children as soon as they're born, and by the time they are 5 or 6, they have an altogether different personality. And when you ask the child, you will feel that he's talking on his own, but those are the words put in by the parents, and that is a subconscious mind which has been trained, brainwashed in such a manner that as young as 6 years old, children even do not know in what direction do they want to go, how do they want to proceed, what toys they like, do they like books or do they like toys. So this is a very dangerous scenario because they have been pushed into psychosis really early, and that means they'll be, and we are seeing nowadays, so 90% of the children, they by the time they get into teenage, they are either depressed or they are so syphilitic. Because there's early psychosis, so there's so much of syphilis that they are suicidal, or they're sexual aversion, sexual, too much of awareness or perversions are there. And the children are going into depression, or they are just indifferent towards society, towards their parents, towards the family. So this is all why, and today also we are seeing like that. So this is, if you have children, please do not do like that. Just let them be the way they are, and they'll evolve into some the original constitution that is there. We as parents are only there to guide them when they need our help, so that they do not get hurt. So that they are just, otherwise we can do nothing. They'll just evolve the way we are. See, okay, so that is the best thing. And believe me, the world is a beautiful place if you just let them be the way they are meant to be. They'll evolve, they'll go into the careers they want to be. And we have seen many a time that children are pushed into careers, or children are pushed into a certain kind of life. And later also, so it's really bad. We are just pushing our generations into syphilis and destruction, nothing else. They'll not be satisfied in life. They'll not be happy in life. Okay. So for For behind this achieving tendency is a greed or a selfish interest. At the very base of it is cowardice and fear of death. The second function of reproduction in a cell was perhaps necessarily developed due to insecure feeling in the cell. Okay, so I've already, I think. I'm a little lost where obstinacy, veratrum. We have already gone through veratrum and platina. Okay, so there's asking, okay. So positivity we have done. He pursues these desires with obstinacy and positivity. Sorry, it is happening that I cannot read the last few lines of every slide because there's a that happening. So I have to read that from books. So it is taking some time. So positivity, okay. For achievement, he may use any means, morals. Behind this achieving tendency is greed or selfish interest. Okay, and this at the very base of it is cowardice or fear of death. The second function of reproduction in a cell was perhaps necessarily developed due to this insecure feeling in the cell. Here, cell is telling us about the evolution process. Okay, why? I think the time is up. Okay, so I'll be taking, it's almost been 1.5 hours. So I'll just continue the sentence and then we'll continue in the next lecture whenever next week. So here what is happening, the second function, which is the reproduction of a cell, which is very important. And it is the base around which our evolution occurred. It was developed. Why was it developed? If we were self-sufficient as a single cell, there was no need, there was no hostile environment, there was no need for self-defense, then we would still have been single celled only. But this second the function of the cell, which was reproduction, it happened in the first place because there was an insecure feeling in the cell. What was the insecure? There was fear of death. There was insecure feeling that I am not safe. And because of that, the cell evolved and developed this reproduction function. And then it gradually we developed into multicellular organisms. And now we have evolved into human beings. Okay. So now we are closing here. Okay. We'll be continuing in the next lecture. If you people have any questions, you people can just ask your questions. We'll be taking the questions later. And believe me, I again appeal to all the homeopaths, all the students who are who are attending Sadhana series. This is a very good opportunity, a great opportunity for every one of you to understand the basics. We are just going back to basics and understand how to become a better homeopath, how to turn from that disillusionment which we all suffer from when we are students, and just be the best version of ourselves as homeopaths, as practitioners, and move ahead in life. So take this series very seriously. And thank you everyone for attending to my lecture patiently. And may you all have a good day.